Welcome, Irish fans, to the Jack Swarbrick Show. After our special football recruiting show last week, we return to the Fighting Irish Media headquarters for this week's edition. As February rolls on, the baseball season is fast approaching, and the Irish baseball team is getting set to open its season with a three-game weekend series at Santa Clara starting February 19th. Head coach Mick Aoki will stop by to give us some insight into the 2016 Irish. The 7th-ranked Irish women's lacrosse team got its season underway last weekend with a big win over three-time defending Atlantic Sun champion Jacksonville. Captain Barbara Sullivan will join us to talk about that game and the season outlook for the women's lacrosse team. But first, to get things started, here are your hosts, Joe Schmidt and Jack Swarbrick.
Well, we're back from our first remote show.
I know.
We seem to survive it. It went okay. So,
at least I think so. I haven't seen the reviews. I try not to look, but
yeah, they were strong. You were on all day. It was like a telethon.
It felt kind of like it. So we had a blast though. We got such a great recruiting class and finally got Coach Elston on the show. I mean that was incredible. Thank you for doing that.
Huge victory. You asked all of us the hot 16.
Yeah, the hot topic.
Hot topic, 16 yeah. questions for the class of 2016.
Oh, yeah.
All the coaches were put through it. The athletic director was put through it. So what was the most memorable response you got that you can share with us?
I can't believe when I asked you who was the better Notre Dame linebacker, Manti Te'o or Joe Schmidt, I just can't believe you said Manti. I really can't. No, but there were some really funny responses from the hot topic. You know, just people choosing, Coach Van Gorder just murmuring steak as to what food he would be. So for the listeners that might be interested in these segments, they're all on watchnd.com, and they're all up there with all the coaches. And then we also have your bit up there, Jack, and Jack has some great responses as well. But before we get into the wonderful weekend that was Notre Dame athletics, I have to ask you, I think I saw your face on the broadcast of the Super Bowl. Was that you?
Yeah, I've heard a rumor of this. I was in attendance.
You were in attendance.
Other than the little bit I did playing piano for Lady Gaga during the national anthem, I was surprised I made it on TV. No, I was there. Had a great time. You know, we have this little rivalry where I'm sort of a Northern California fan and you're a Southern California guy. And it was four spectacular weather days in the Bay Area. I don't think you could go there this time of year and get days like that. Crystal clear and not very windy, great temperatures. And it all worked very well. I was interested to go out there because I was part of the process for picking Levi's Stadium to host the college football playoffs in a few years.
Right.
And so I wanted to see how it worked, and the logistics were great. It's you got in and out fine. The stadium sets up really well for an event like that, and I had a special rooting interest, I think, known Peyton for a long time, so I was pulling for Denver. But in addition, David Bruton and Ryan Harris are on the Broncos. Not to slight our Carolina guy, but we had two on the Broncos along with Peyton. So I was rooting for them, and certainly Cam's time will come. But it was good to see Peyton get that last one.
I mean, I think it's just amazing how young and talented that Carolina Panthers team is, and the future for them is so bright. But really, for a defensive guy, that game was just so much fun to watch. I mean, I know that a lot of my friends were texting me during the game and saying, you know, this game is terrible, blah blah blah. But I thought it was awesome, and I thought that the quality of defense and really just what Denver did up front was just it was amazing. And I don't know if you thought the same thing sitting there, but I had to say.
Yeah, no, you had to appreciate the defense. There were so many great defensive players on the field. But I was really surprised at the amount of pressure Denver was getting with four rushers. And they were able to stay in their lanes,
yeah.
You know, keep that pocket maintained. But, you know, I think if Carolina had pulled that game out, Kuechly would have been the MVP.
Yeah.
because he was all over the field. He was tackling everybody.
I mean, he's an incredible player, and every time I talk to one of the linebackers here, or the guy I love to joke about it with is Dan Fox, because we say we took Fox over Keekly back in the day, and Dan loves saying it. So for those of you who don't know, Dan's a former linebacker here at Notre Dame, and we're of the opinion that if he continues to play at this high level and improve like he has, he might go down as the greatest of all time to play the linebacker position, and he really showed it during the game. He's so fast, explosive, and he does everything really well. But
reminds me of Joe Schmidt.
I was gonna say it sounds a lot like another guy. I know, yeah. But let's move forward now onto the weekend of Notre Dame athletics, and the one where I have to start is the huge upset victory over North Carolina. But I kind of get mad when people keep calling these upsets. It's like,
right,
we're crushing the top five when they come into to Purcell Pavilion. What did you think of the game?
Yeah, well, it was a great continuation of that tradition, and it is so fun to look at it. All of the number ones
I know
over the years that have come in here, and of course some of the most memorable games in college basketball history, like the UCLA game. Digger would want me to say
that. I was going to say, you had to throw that one in there.
That's right. But, it was a great effort. I love the toughness that's developing in this team, because what a great first half. And there was no panic. There was a great resilience in both the Duke game and this game. When the stakes are kind of the highest, Bonzi really gets juiced by that, and the energy he brings, the loose balls he was getting to, but the whole team played well. We're so fortunate to have the guys we have on that squad. Obviously a huge game, but in some ways I thought the next one was even more important,
right?
Because you've only got a 48-hour turnaround. You're going to the home venue of an ACC team that hasn't lost there. You're tied with them in the ACC standings, and you go in there and you play. You know, they were ahead the entire game, played really well.
You know, I think we talk about it a lot, but I really don't know if people truly understand how great of a coach Coach Bray is, and I have no problem saying that. I think he's amazing to get a team that was on such an emotional high that, the fans storm the court, celebrate with them on a Saturday night here in South Bend, and then to get ready to play on a big Monday at Clemson and to play the way they did. And really just be, a force on the basketball court was amazing. And I think I gotta tip my cap to Coach and the guys for coming out and just being ready to play, because that was amazing. I don't know how basketball teams do that, because I know after a football game, I don't even want to think about playing a full game until about Wednesday. And then I'm starting to, get ready for that. So the way they turn around is incredible.
Well, and especially, we got a lot of great contributions against Clemson. Matt Ryan came in and hit some big shots. Torres gave us some great minutes. But, pretty much Demetrius and Steve Vastoria don't come off the court anymore. And increasingly Rex doesn't come off the court anymore. And with back-to-backs like that, when you're playing the full load of minutes, it really is tough. And you could see we were pretty tired at the end of that game, but boy, they persevered. And I love the way, notwithstanding that they were very tired, they down the stretch they hit every free throw. They were great. But speaking of great coaches, we had a couple of great women's victories.
We did
during this period of time too. A really big win over the weekend against Louisville. I was actually. I was watching the game on my phone on the bus ride down to Levi's Stadium for the game, and there's like 4 minutes left, and we hit the stadium, and I don't have cell coverage anymore.
Oh, no.
So I was dying. Finally got a text message from somebody letting me know what happened. But a really big win for the women, ranked number 3, maybe number 2 now with South Carolina's loss to UConn. But go down into a tough venue in Louisville, sold out against a very good Louisville team, down virtually the whole game. And at the end of it, I thought our experience really shone through.
Yeah, I mean, our team is just so tough, and the girls battle so hard. And I think, we talked about this when we had Lindsay on, the leadership that they have and their ability to kind of fight through any adversity. And we talked even about just being ready for every game. Well, that was a big one. And they really delivered on a big stage and won on the road in a tough environment. So, I mean, I just think there's a lot of good things to be said about both basketball programs right now, and obviously the direction that the women have been going in for so long, and the men are obviously right there with them now, and it's great to see Notre Dame really being just very excelling in all sports right
yeah.
now.
You mentioned Lindsay. She was announced this week. She's a finalist for the Lieberman Award for best point guard, and I can't imagine a circumstance under which she wouldn't have been a finalist. She runs that show so well. And Madison Cable, who's really been a difference maker in recent games, was the ACC Player of the Week, and deservedly so. She has just been outstanding for this team, and you can just see her confidence growing. I'm excited to see what the rest of the year holds for her.
Oh, yeah. I mean, she's always been such a good shooter, and really I think this her entire career here, she's been so good at that. But I think she's really contributing in so many ways on the floor right now, and she's a fifth-year, fourth-year senior, and she's doing such a great job, you know, leading this team as well. So I think she's had a great year, and I'm looking forward to the rest of it.
Yeah, she's an energy player. She brings such energy, such toughness. She's amazing. Speaking of guests who have been on our show, Molly Seidel, not to be confused with Seidel.
Not to be confused.
Molly helped us get that right, set the school record in the 3,000 meters last weekend in a time of 8:57, which is about, only about – you know, what I do 1,000 meters in.
I was going to say, what?
it gives her the number one time in the country. So here you have the NCAA cross-country champion, the indoor champion in the 5,000, and now in the 3,000, going to number one in the country. She's on fire.
That doesn't even make sense to me. I don't understand how she does all of these amazing feats on the track and off the track, for that matter, on cross country. Because she's running such far distances at such low speeds that she just continues to get better. It doesn't make any sense. So the program that they've built over there, with on the track team, it's amazing, and hats off to her for her success. And it was fun. I walked around the Mayo and kind of watched the events transpire that day. It was cool.
That is neat. And keeping with the themes of guests on our show, another one who's just been red hot is Cal Peterson. Hockey, who's now ranked eighth in the country, went and swept Vermont last week. They're 12-2-2 in Hockey East, tied for first place in the league. They are playing really well, and a lot of it has to do with a really solid defense.
Yeah, I think they struggled a few years ago as they kind of went through the growing phases of this program, but now these guys are getting older, they're more solidified, they're veteran guys now, and they're really playing great hockey. And I think Coach Jackson's done a great job kind of developing the guys and building a really great culture. And obviously they've had the hockey team's had such success over the last 5-10 years, but really I think that this team is doing so well, and it's been fun to kind of watch their growth though. And that's kind of what I wanted to hit on, is the growth that this team has had and these guys have had. It's just really fascinating.
Yeah. All the national news outlets are following the New Hampshire primary, and now on to South Carolina. We're focused on a different election here at Notre Dame.
We are.
So as we end this first segment, I got to ask you for your prediction, because by the time this airs, we'll know the outcome. But how do we think Mr. Robinson is going to do in his candidacy to be the student body president?
Well, here's what I think should happen. I think Corey should win in an absolute landslide, and anyone that votes for another candidate is just outside of their mind, because Corey is the absolute most impressive individual I think I've ever met. I don't think there is a better candidate, dead or alive, other than Jesus Christ, that could be the president of the student body here at Notre Dame. And I really do hope that he won. And I think that, Corey and Becca Blaze, his vice president, have a unique platform, and they're championing all the right things. And Corey cares so much about his fellow students. I've never seen anyone more well liked than Corey is, and that cares more about this university. So even if he doesn't win, because I like to put my hand down and joke, but even if he doesn't win, he's a great ambassador for this university, and he's one of my best friends, obviously, and I hope he won, and I think he did.
Well, we wish him well, but I must acknowledge the campaign manager for another campaign is
we is must one,
acknowledge.
Why
is
must
one
we acknowledge?
Jerry Tillery.
Why?
We'll be back with our guests in a minute.